Welcome class to this 13th lecture on angular momentum. So it's the 13th lecture in the list of lectures that you got on the semester topic. It's also, I believe, the 13th time that I'm trying myself to record this thing online. So it reminds me very much of this Eastern philosophy where they tell you that when you did something very painful, when you get at the end of some terrible challenge, what you should do is start again from scratch, do it anew, just to realize that it was not so bad in the first time, right? And actually, we are going today to see something which is also pretty much Eastern philosophy, namely the quantum mechanics of angular momentum. The title is written there, so we'll start quantum angular momentum. We'll start to remind ourselves from last lecture that angular momentum classically is defined like this. So the momentum mv in quantum mechanics is an operator, which in 3D is related to this gradient. And this is a vector as well. So we've got the x component in the I direction, the y component, and the z component. And we have seen last time that these three operators, Lx, Ly, Lz, are not compatible. What does it mean not to be compatible? It means that the operators do not commute. Actually, we can be more accurate in which way they don't commute. If you remember, this is the cyclic relation between the three components, x, y, and z. Yeah? So it means that if I know the x component of the angular momentum, then I am restricted in my knowledge of the y and the z component. So they are not good observable to represent or to characterize the state. On the other hand, we have seen that any of them, Lk, where k is x, y, or z, does commute with L square. L square being defined, of course, as the, from Pythagoras, the square of the components, the scalar product of L with itself. That's L square. Y square, z square. Right. So by convention, we use that commutes. We use the z component. Yeah, that's a bit arbitrary, but that's the one that everybody uses. That's called the quantization axis. Right. So that means that there exist some eigenstates, some functions, which are simultaneous eigenstates of both L square and Lz. So I remind you what it is to be an eigenstate. It means that the operator L squared, let's try to do something fancy, the operator L square or the operator Lz become transformed into scalars, which we will call lambda for the L square and mu for the Lz square. So far they are just notation. Actually, this lecture is about finding the relationship and the expression for these eigenvalues of the L square and Lz operators, right? And to do that, we also introduced last time, let's come back to some more decent colors, we'll introduce, what did I do now? Oh my, that's not so bad as to make me start again the lecture, so we'll leave with that. We introduced these operators, which were called L plus minus. Yeah, they were defined, so I put the three equal sign to mean the definition, are Lx plus minus ILz. You see, it's interesting already, sorry, Ly. It's interesting because we are using the z component of the angular momentum, and to do that, we need to consider this the superposition of the x and y components. So there is a nice relationship between the various components of this L vector. So what is the role of this operator that we introduced last time? The first thing is that this operator commutes with L square. So this is easy to see actually. Yeah? Commutes, which means the commutator is zero. It's easy to see because by linearity of the commutator. Yeah? That's L square. And you remember that this thing is linear, which means that I can do this thing. Interesting. Yeah. Well, that's a new level of mathematics. This we cannot do in class. Huh? L square LZ, and this is zero, yeah, and this is zero because that's what we wrote there when we had the K still before, yeah. I have to put arrows everywhere because you don't see my fingers showing the things. It's just as good that you don't see what I'm doing, yeah, because I'm in my bed without a pair of pants right now, so, well, you only see the screen. Anyway, L square commutes with L plus minus, very good. And with LZ, what we have is, no, of course not. Of course, we don't have the commutation here as well, because X and Y don't commute and they don't cancel, but they give a nice relationship. It's equal to plus or minus H bar L plus minus. That's the two relationship which are important for this new operator. Why this is so? Because the statement, the important statement is that if Psi, so this is what I wrote here, if Psi is an eigenstate of L square with eigenvalue lambda, that's the first line, and an eigenstate, and an eigenstate of LZ with eigenvalue mu, then so is L plus minus Psi, okay? L plus minus Psi, which is a new function, that's the result of applying this operator on this function, that's phi, but we don't need this new notation. So this object, I can put in some given color to keep in mind that it's a function of some sort. This object is also an eigenstate of L square and LZ, okay? That's the same thing, so we put it back here. Therefore, okay, it's an eigenvalue. It means that it get transformed. It get transformed into scalars. The operator becomes scalars. Let's put the operators in a different color. So we don't know what are the eigenvalues so far. We are going to compute them. So let's use the next letters. We use lambda and mu. So we'll use nu and eta, for instance. Now we are going to prove this fact. So first one is actually easy to prove, yeah, because you remember that we start from this. I'll copy that there as a starting point. You remember that L square commutes with L plus minus is what is written here, yeah. It commutes, it means that I can change the order. So I can put this guy here. Let's make a bit of space. Okay, this one comes here. Yeah, we have to do it well. Okay, that's the commutation, yeah. We started from this line above, okay? And L square Psi, we know what it is because by assumption, this is an eigenstate. So this is lambda Psi. This I take from here, right? That's L square Psi. So I need, of course, to keep the L plus minus. Now, lambda is a scalar, which means that I can commute it also with the operators, okay? More or less. And we have the statement because we started there. I shouldn't have removed so much actually, but we started there from L square L plus minus Psi. So indeed this state here, you recognize the same state here, is what transformed this L square operator into a scalar. So we prove the first statement. If Psi is an eigenstate of L square, then L plus minus Psi is also an eigenstate of L square with the same eigenvalue. So now we know that mu equal lambda, so I can remove this mu and replace it by lambda. This is proved. When something is proved, we put a check like this. Okay, we'll now proceed to prove the second one, which is almost as easy. So I will not remove, doesn't look like I've did this 13 times already. I keep forgetting what I should keep or not. So we start from there, and the idea is the same, just that they don't commute, these guys. Remember, what we have is that they're equal to plus minus H bar L plus minus. So LZ L plus minus is by definition LZ L plus minus minus L plus minus LZ. That's what it means to be a commutator, which is equal, which is what I have here, to plus minus H bar L plus minus. Therefore, this LZ here, these guys, LZ L plus minus, LZ L plus minus is equal, let's try to do that. I remove this, I remove this, and what I want to do is, this that I always dream to do, pass this on the other side. Yeah, so this minus disappears and then we've got a plus. So now I can replace this L plus minus there by this right hand side. But I put it there. I need to put some parentheses, of course. Psi, and now we can compute. Yeah, I moved it rather than copy it. Okay, doesn't matter. Now we can compute, we can distribute the psi, which I will do like this. Copier, coller. You learn a bit of French at the same time, so now we don't need the parentheses anymore. Thank you very much. And now we compute. Yeah, the handwriting is not perfect, but hopefully you follow what I'm doing. So this, I think they were right, huh? to confine us. So this LZ psi, by definition, is mu psi. Mu psi L plus minus. Yeah, here I. Let's take a sober color. I replace this thing. Now we carry on. Plus minus h bar L plus minus psi. The mu here can get outside, can commute with the operator because it's a scalar, so I can put it there. And now I can factorize the L plus minus, which you see. Let's introduce new concepts like this. You see that this is L plus minus. I can factorize, therefore I got mu plus minus h bar L plus minus psi. And that proves our final statement, which was that, I like this thing of the color. Let's remove it there and use it again. What color is nice? What color would Govind like? This one. You like this one, Govind, don't you? Are you even listening to this? I mean, is someone got so far as there? So this object here, which we recognize there, it transformed this function, transform this operator LZ into a scalar, mu plus minus h bar. So that proves the second statement. I can put back in green. If psi is an eigenstate of LZ, then so is L plus minus psi. And furthermore, now we know the eigenvalue, we just demonstrated it. The eigenvalue is, what would you write? You would write this thing which is here, mu plus minus h bar. Right. So this is all very good, because with this we can proceed to actually find what is the value of lambda and mu. Yeah, this one, this lambda and mu. We can characterize what they are. To do that, we need to introduce the relationship between L square and LZ, which is something that was asked in the tutorial last time. So this you have demonstrated already, hopefully. If not, please try to find it. It's easy, it's just the algebra of this operator. It's easy to derive, but it's not easy to write. How do I get rid of this? Maybe if I do it, I don't know. I'm sorry that I'm losing rhythm. Okay, found it. Minus plus h bar lz. Okay, so this result comes from your tutorials. So if you couldn't find this, please complain to Camilo. He will explain how to find you this. So we are going to apply this thing on psi, on a particular type of psi, actually, because you see that if we look at the physical sense, so far we did a lot of algebra, but let's come back to physics. Remember that L square is basically the magnitude, the length of the angular momentum, right? LZ is its projection. Yeah, so if we would put it like this on the sphere, that's the Z axis. We say that LZ and LXY, so that's XY here, they are not compatible. So I cannot know X, Y, and Z simultaneously, but I can know the length of my vector, that's L square, and I can know its Z projection. Then it's undefined, it's undetermined like this, the x and y component, yeah, which are these things. We don't know what they are. So it kind of precedes or lives in this in this area of the sphere. But that's basically what we can find. We can find that L square is related to lambda, LZ is related to mu. And if I apply this L plus minus operator, what happens is that the length L square, let me take this thing. Okay. The length L square remains the same, it still remains lambda, but the z component increase or decrease depending if I apply plus or if I apply minus. Yeah, the increase or the decrease. Okay, so now let's think about it. If I increase my z component forever by applying this L plus, at some point my z component, because it increases, yeah, so we go from there to there, let us say, in this color. I increase it, but the length is the same, so I stay on the sphere. So at some point, because the z components keep increasing, I will get to the situation where my z component will be larger than the L square, and this is not possible, of course. We can see it a bit more accurately in this way. If you look at the average value, like this, of L square, yeah, so that's the average value of L square. So by the definition of L square and by linearity of all this business, I can break it in this way. Okay. And now, now the argument goes as follows. By definition, this is mu squared. Yeah, because LZ, this we should keep in mind. Let me put the red box around because we refer to this all the time. LZ psi is mu psi, therefore, of course, LZ square, which is LZ psi, this is mu psi, LZ mu psi is mu LZ psi is mu psi, therefore, this is this, yeah? Okay, this is clear, right? So, here we've got mu square, and here we've got this one, which is lambda square. Okay, I'm showing you again, that's this one. L square psi, is lambda, average value of lambda. Okay. And because these are observables, this Lx, Ly, and Lz, they are so-called Hermitian, which means that their eigenvalues are real. Yeah? So if the eigenvalues are real, that would be as well the square of some real number, and the square of the real number is positive. That's the square of some real number, that's also positive. So we've got mu square, which is positive, plus the sum of two positive numbers, which is equal to lambda, which means that mu square should be smaller than or equal to lambda, at least smaller. Because of the uncertainty principle, you are invited to work on this in the tutorial, you can actually show that it has to be a strict inequality. It cannot be equal, except in some particular case where they are zero. But usually it's strictly less than the thing, right? Mu square is less than lambda. Okay. Which means, therefore, because mu square, that's the eigenvalue of the LZ component, right? Of the LZ state, right? So if I keep applying L plus to my state psi, this one as lambda, this one as the eigenvalue for LZ, as the eigenvalue lambda plus h bar. So then I can apply it again, L plus, and this one as the eigenvalue h bar lambda plus 2 h bar. I can apply it another time, and this has lambda plus 3 h bar, so on and so forth, yeah? But all of them have the same, it's the same color, these things. Let me take something, this one. For L square, they all have the same eigenvalue, which is lambda. These guys are, of course, mu. That's mu, because you are looking here at the eigenvalue of the LZ operator. So they're all mu. But all these guys in green, we are looking at the eigenvalues of the L square operator. So that's lambda, 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 lambda. They all have the same eigenvalue lambda. That comes from here. Yeah, that we show that remains the same for L square, but that increase by h bar because you are looking at the plus for LZ. Okay? So all this to say what? I told you it looks very much like Eastern philosophy, Oriental philosophy, this business of quantum agreement. All this to say that we can have an eigen state, which Z component is arbitrarily large, because if I iterate this process a sufficient number of times, n can be as large as I want. Yeah, I can make it 10 to infinity. This should still remain less than lambda. Okay, and this is not possible, of course, because this is constant, and this increases forever. So it means that this process has to stop at some point. It means that there exists, that's typical thing of the creation operator. Yeah, we made that already for the harmonic oscillator. It means that there exists a state psi t, which has eigenvalue lambda for L square, and it has eigenvalue, I will call it mu t. T is for top, yeah? Mu t for the state psi t, such that, so there exists psi t, such that applying L plus on LZ psi t will lead us to zero. Yeah, it's impossible to increase, to add some Z component to the angular momentum, because we would have more Z angular momentum than we have the total angular momentum, which is not possible. Okay, so this condition exists. For the same reason, you can check yourself that there also exists a psi bottom, such that L square psi bottom is equal to some eigenvalue lambda, and L Z psi bottom will be equal to mu bottom, this time psi b, such that, again, I could have copied this one, but it was so badly written in the first place that it was not useful. Such that, so you guess what I will write here, L minus going down LZ psi bottom is equal to zero. Actually, it's applying on the state itself, not on the LZ component. That's the condition, L plus and L minus. Okay, there exist these two states. Okay, so with the knowledge that these two states exist, invoking this relationship here, I will copy that. We're going to compute the eigen state and eigen value. Let me copy that. Yeah. Okay. Okay, so let's apply indeed L square on our psi top. So I put psi top on both sides, which means if I distribute it, that it gets projected on all the operators. You see that there is the plus minus of the algebra, and then there is the plus minus here, which are to label the operator, creation or destruction operator. So we are going to use this. We are going to use this for the upper part, which means, no, for the bottom part. So like this. Yeah, so I kill all the others. I kill this one, and this one. And I can kill the little color, and we are left with this. And now we compute. Okay, so this is zero, because we said that trying to add some Z component to this top eigenstate leads us to zero. That's what is written here, right? So this is zero, which means we remove it. Then we've got LZ square psi t. So this we computed before, what this is. LZ psi t is mu t, it's written there. So that's mu t square, because I applied LZ twice, psi t, plus h bar LZ, so that h bar psi t, LZ psi t, that's mu t psi t. Okay, if we do the same now, let's copy this again. And this time let's do it with the bottom part. I'm mixing the options that I want to use. We want to do it the bottom part. So many colors to choose from. Okay. So for the bottom part, we are going to use not the upper part, the upper part. So we are going to use this, this, and this. Yeah, I can only use the upper part or the lower part at the same time. Of course, that's the notation. It's to write two equations in a single shot. Okay, so let me remove the little colors. We compute again. I removed too much here because now I've got two minus. What did I do? Yeah, I removed the plus. Okay, so that's like this. Not that it matters anyway, because this part here cancels the thing. Like L minus psi b is written here. L minus psi b is equal to zero. So this is zero. I don't care what is this operator. Everybody goes. Okay, and now we are left with L the square psi b is mu b square psi b, and this is equal to minus h bar mu b psi b. Okay, that's for the L square. And at the same time, L square is written there and there, are equal to lambda, lambda psi t, and this one is equal to lambda, not this one, I want this one, is equal to lambda psi b. So we've got, if we simplify the wave function on both sides, we've got from the first line, we've got lambda is equal to mu t square plus h bar mu t, and the same lambda is equal to mu b square minus h bar mu b. Okay, so here I've got this dipole, so I can put it like this actually, dipole because they're equal to lambda. Let me write it like this. Okay, so that's a beautiful equation that we're going to solve. So actually, we've got this h-bar, which is in the way. Oops. We have this h-bar, which is in the way. And we are trying to compute mu t and mu b. So they are not defined yet. Yeah? It's just notation for them. They could be anything. So we could factorize the h-bar. We could put it in the mu. So we can do it like this. We can say that mu t is h-bar mu lambda t. Yeah, so I introduce a new variable, the same for the bottom one. And now we introduce these things in the equation above. That gives us h bar squared mu t tilde plus h bar squared mu t tilde. I've got the h bar squared here because I've got this h bar and this h bar. Okay. And the first one, I got the h bar squared because that's the square. Okay. So the interest of doing this is that if we do it also for mu b on the right hand side, we'll get in the same way h bar square mu b plus h bar square mu b. And you see where this leads us, this change of variable, that it gets rid of the h bar square of the h bar. So we've got this even more friendly equation that we are going to solve. It's missing a tilde there. So this equation, either you see it right away, which is the solution, or you have to solve it the old-fashioned way. Yeah. So if you don't see it, you can pause the video and try to guess the answer. But if you don't, we do it as we would do it in foundation here, because this is a quadratic equation. Yeah, we've got a square here, linear term. We can take this as a constant. So let me write it like this. Square plus mu t. And then we've got minus, I will bring everybody on the same side, equals zero. So what is the solution of this? There are two solutions because it's quadratic. So it's, what is it? It's minus b, which is minus one, plus minus square root divided by 2a. A is one, so we divide by two. Discriminant is b square, which is one. B square minus 4ac, minus minus is plus. 4, one times c is this mu b square plus mu b tilde. Here I made another mistake, of course, which is I put a plus there, which should be a minus. Yeah, you see, it's very painful when there's no interaction because I should be flawless. Otherwise, you catch the mistake and get confused forever. So that becomes a minus there. Yeah, when we're in class, I can blame you. I can say you were not paying attention, but yeah, I can't blame you because maybe you noticed I was going wrong, and you have to suffer until I find my way back. Okay, so as I said, you could for the mu t, we are solving for the mu t. You could have tried to guess the solution. So did you guess that it was this? Yeah, probably not. Because there is simplification there. The simplification is if you look at the term in the square root, the radicand, it is a perfect square. It is a perfect square, yeah? Because this is, what do I mean by perfect square? I mean that this is something like 2 mu b, is it minus 1 square? There is a tilde for everybody. Let's expand this, that's 4 mu b square minus double product, which is 4 mu b tilde plus 1. And this is what we have, 4 mu b square minus 4 mu b tilde is here with this 4 and the plus 1 is there. Yeah, so that's a double product. And the fact that it's a double product, that simplifies a lot because this square root, which is here, it gives us 4 mu t tilde minus 1 plus minus divided by 2. The square root of the square is 2 mu b tilde minus 1. If we simplify this, we've got minus 1 plus 2 mu b minus 1, and we divide by 2, that's mu b tilde minus 1, isn't it? I think so. Minus 1, minus 1, that's minus 2, we divide by 2, that's it. Okay, so that's one solution, and the other solution is first solution, or, we don't know yet. The other possible solution is with the minus. So minus 1 minus minus 1 is cancelled. Minus 1 plus 1 is 0. So we are left with minus mu b tilde. Yeah? So that's our two solutions. That's the one you could have guessed at this stage. When we were looking at this equation here, you could have said, ah, okay, in this shape, mu t is minus mu b or mu b minus 1. You can check and that it works. You can check here. Maybe it was a bit of an overkill to go through this detail. I could have given you a solution. Let's come back to the physics of it now. Remember, mu t is associated to the state to which we cannot add angular momentum. Yeah, that's zero. So that's the state which is at the top. It has as much angular momentum as possible. Yeah. If I add more, it stops because then you would exceed the total angular momentum. It's at the top. And psi b on the other hand, the one that has again value mu b for Lz, is the one which is at the bottom. So that's psi t and that's psi b. I cannot remove angular momentum. Okay. Okay, so the z component of psi t, which is mu t, it could be either mu b minus 1 or minus mu b, or maybe it could be both. Well, actually, it cannot be the first one because it tells us that the top angular momentum, which is here, yeah, this value there, it's equal to the bottom minus 1. Yeah, so it's smaller than the bottom one. It cannot be that the top angular momentum, the maximum value, is smaller than the minimum value. It is not physical. It's not good. We can reject it. Not good. Not good. And the second solution, on the other hand, is good, because if mu b is negative, then we would like it to be negative, because actually it's pointing downward, so downward below the plane of x, y, it looks like it's negative. Then we have that mu t is the opposite of mu b. So that's very good, actually. That's a good solution. Good solution. We are going to retain it. So we characterize these guys. Nice color again. We characterize this guy and this guy. So now we know that they are opposite. Yeah. Mu t. So mu t, if you remember, was we introduced that. What was it? H bar mu t is mu t tilde, was it? Let's see what it's written. H bar mu t tilde is mu t. It's opposite. Okay. Okay, so what did I introduce the tilde? Below, what we have is the tilde at the opposite. Yeah? The tilde at the opposite. So, the tilde at the opposite, we've got as well h bar mu b is mu b, and this is equal to minus h bar mu t tilde, which is itself equal to minus mu t. So we've got this, mu t is equal to minus mu b. I will write this result again there. Mu t is equal to minus mu b. So now we have this relationship, just in case you only read the note shown below. I don't know if I will survive even this lecture, actually. Pretty much, I don't keep track of the time, and possibly very much over time. It's very difficult then to do it online like that. Okay, so fair enough. Good. We find this relationship. So we've got mu t and mu b. So I will put the bottom one here, that mu b tilde, which is minus h bar mu, and I've got mu t tilde, which is h bar mu. Mu being the maximum value, and then the minimum value, the one of the bottom state, I know is the opposite. And then each time I look at the z component of the L plus psi state, yes, so this one, the one that corresponds to psi b, if I apply L plus for the z component, so the Lz here of this guy as the eigenvalue minus h bar mu, I jump to a new state, psi b prime, whatever. This new state has the eigenvalue minus h bar mu plus h bar. Remember, if we apply the operator L plus, we add one quantum of angular momentum. Good. So we make this jump like this to an eigenvalue, which is, so I will sketch it like this with a little arrow, minus h bar mu plus h bar. Yeah. So I can apply again this L plus operator, and I will go to a state with minus h bar mu plus 2 h bar. Yeah. So I can apply again the L plus operator. Clack, clack, clack. So here, let's use the power of this thing to make space, which we cannot do within space. Maybe I can even, can I? Yeah, I can do something like this. Reduce the thing. Okay, because then I want to jump many times until I start to go there. So there I will get h mu minus h bar. I will arrive at this thing, and then I jump again and I arrive at h bar mu. Yeah, so I'm making integer steps because I'm adding h bar each time between the possible eigenvalue. Okay, so let's consider, let's assume that we've got n such state, n being an integer. That's a number. Maybe zero step, we'll consider one step, two step, three steps, so on and so forth. Yeah, let's go till four step. You see, even on the iPad, I touch the border systematically. So if we got n state, the top state, this one, h bar nu, is reached from starting from the bottom state, from this one, by adding n times h bar. Yeah, here we jump n times, applying the L plus operator from the bottom state to reach the top state. Okay, so this equation is very friendly because we can pass this on the other side. We get 2 h bar mu is equal to n h bar. So we'll cancel the h bar right away to solve this equation, which is indeed n divided by 2. Okay. And that's a great result because we find that this mu, remember, this mu is this eigenvalue of our Lz operator. Yeah, we started there. Mu is our eigenvalue of our Lz operator. At the beginning, we didn't know anything about it. Yeah. Now we know that it's an integer of alpha integer. Yeah, it can be 0, so it can be 0, 1 half, 1, 3 half, 2, so on and so forth. So that's mu. Okay, so lambda is equal to, so it was from mu t, it was mu t square plus h bar mu t. And for mu b, it was with the minus. But now we know that mu t is, the maximum one is h bar mu. Yeah, it's written there. So we've got h bar square, I can factorize, mu square plus h bar square, I can factorize as well, mu. Okay, so that's the relationship with for lambda, which we would also get using the lambda b. Yeah, that will give the same result. So this actually, we prefer to write in this way. We will factorize the mu, and that gives us mu plus 1. Mu plus 1. Okay. And mu is, as is written there, is an half integer. So we find both lambda and mu. And I can add the color there. We find these two things. Lambda is h bar square L divided by 2. Let me write it. Let me write it, HB, but I can't speak anymore. So the h bar square N divided by 2 N2 plus 1. And this is, okay. So I remove it just in case you want to go through the notes again, so that they keep some more or less chronological order. Okay, so we've got these two things in the box. Very good. So let's look at some particular case for the number of steps. If we take zero step, actually, we don't go for anything. So we need that minus the number is equal to the number itself. The only number which is equal to its opposite is zero. So the eigenvalue of the angular momentum here is zero. It's the only choice. N equal one, we will go from minus n, so minus 1/2, to 1/2, h bar 2. I need an h bar here. Yeah, I forgot that. At this stage, I forgot that I went from the tilde to the not tilde. Again, right. N equal to in two steps. So we go from minus h bar, then we add h bar, that's 0, and we add h bar, that brings us to 2 divided by 2 h bar. So that's good. N equal 3.
That brings us from minus 3 half h bar. If I add 1 h to this, I go to minus h bar over 2. I add 1 h bar, it's h bar over 2. I add 1 h bar, I go to 3 half h bar. N equal 4, minus 2 h bar, minus h bar, 0 h bar, 2 h bar. Yeah?
So for the total angular momentum, the L square again value, which has the value n, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 4, we've got n plus 1 possible states. Yeah? You can see that here we jump from 1 to the other by step of h bar. So that's the result of applying the L plus operator between these states. It gives us this eigen value. So far we only work with the eigen values. Yeah? If we would go, by the way, in the other directions, so let me put that for this call. That's the result of applying L plus. That gives us the value of LZ when I apply L plus. If I go in the other direction, yeah, applying L minus, I remove one quantum of angular momentum. So I go like this. Yeah. Let me do all of them because it's so satisfying and they will allow me a little break. Okay. Very good. So far we only find the eigenvalue, but we characterize, we solve completely the problem. In principle, we find these things, yeah? They have this structure. They go from minus an integer or half integer of h bar by integer step of h bar to the opposite number. That's the structure of the L square and LZ. Structure. That's the structure of these things. Okay, I use basically all the colors I could. That's why it be like that. Now we are going to look at the eigenstate, now that we find the eigenfunction. And this I'll go much quicker because I'll invite you to look at the canvas notes, because it's probably, the algebra is a bit heavier than this one actually. So I don't know if it was fun to look at. It certainly wasn't fun to record. It's probably even more painful to look at. But if we would do the same for the eigenstate, everybody would go crazy. Yeah. So I'll just sketch the idea. The idea is just to look, is to solve this eigenvalue problem now. Let's change the color, at least we change something. Yeah. So it's to solve this story that LZ of psi. Now we want to find the wave function. Yeah. So R theta phi LZ. So it will be some integer. I will use the integer m, number of h bar of the wave function. And it's a simultaneous, so the same wave function, eigen state of L square. But this time we said with the eigen value. So I will not use n divided by 2, I will use this number L, L plus 1, yeah, instead of n divided by 2. It's a change of notation, psi. So to find the eigenstate, which means to find this function here, we just need to solve these things. So to solve these things for the function, which means in terms of this variable, we need to express this operator LZ and L square as differential operator, yeah. And this is actually not so difficult. Remember that LZ was R vectorial minus I h bar gradient. That was our starting point. That's L, this thing, yeah. So to do that quickly, we need to express this and these things in a spherical coordinate, because you see that we are expressing eigenstate in terms of r, theta and phi. At the same time, we are working all the time with a Cartesian thing, x, y and z. So actually we are going to use both, but we start with the Cartesian coordinates. We have the gradient. We start with the gradient. So what is the gradient in spherical coordinate? This you've seen several times now, so probably it's not needed to do it again, but do it just in case in the tutorial, or just to annoy Camilo, make him apply the chain rule on this thing. So the gradient is not the most difficult. Laplacian is really a mess, but the gradient is something like this. We've got the theta derivative, and then we've got the 1 divided by r sine theta d phi. So these guys are theta and phi. They are the vectors, yeah, the unit vectors in spherical coordinates. That's x, y, z. And then we've got, at a given point, we've got our little vector r, our little vector theta, and then our little vector phi. And they are unit vectors, that's why I put the hat, okay? Okay, so, if I look at these things, I can bring back, let's tidy up all these things, yeah? Let's put this in front, let's remove that shouldn't be there, like this, boom boom, okay. Let's bring this closer to the family in terms of confinement. Everybody should do that. Okay, so to get L, I need to multiply minus I h bar r times things, yeah. So this is equal to, bit of room please, this is equal to minus I h bar r vectorial this. I will distribute it everywhere, r vectorial this and r vectorial this, okay. That's an angular momentum written in terms of operator in spherical coordinate. So far so good. So let's look at the various terms. Let's look at this one first, the dr term, yeah. Here we've got this Now I go ballistic with the colors. We've got this R vectorial R. So this guy is R, R, right? And this is clearly zero. That's the vector product of something which with itself. Not even the line with itself. It's the vector product of something with itself. So it's clearly zero. Yeah. Remember, vector product should be independent. So this happily cancels. Yeah. Can remove all these guys. Okay. I will leave it so that we have it in the note, but it's zero. No, something more violent. This is not the color of oblation. I don't know. Okay. So it's cancelled. It's zero. Okay. Let's look at this one. No. This one. So R times theta is the right hand rule on this thing, which is orthonormal. R sine theta is equal to phi. R theta is equal to phi. And R vector product phi is not equal to theta because they are not in the good order. The opposite order would give theta, so it's minus theta. Okay, so let's make this substitution. I will remove this because it's so ugly. Yeah, and it will make room for R minus IH bar, which is actually more important. Okay, so we said R times theta is phi. And this one is minus theta. Minus theta. Okay. Good. And of course, parenthesis here. Parenthesis here. Okay. Is it something that is helping us? L is minus I h bar. There was. This R shouldn't be there because it was R vectorial theta. Yeah. And the thing which is equal to phi is R at, normalized at. So this is R at now. Yeah. This is R vector. Okay. So that cancels these things. I mean, check it carefully, but trust me, it's not there and it's not there. This I cannot, I don't think I can remove it. I need to write it again. Okay. In which context do you get the sign whose first letter is different from the rest? Anyway. So that's the good result. That's the angular momentum. L equal to these things. Yeah, in which case we don't need it there. Okay. And we can put this here. Siri, I don't know what you feel of all this, but I know you don't like when it goes. I don't know how to put it. Well, you get the idea. Maybe I can reduce it a little bit with the two finger. No. Okay, more or less. So that's the angular momentum in spherical coordinates. That's a good result. Yeah. But as I told you, we need Lx, Ly, and Lz all the time. So at this stage, what we do is that we write these guys, this psi and this theta, we write them in Cartesian coordinate, and this is as well something that that you should have shown at some point from differential calculus in 3D. So it's 3D calculus so far. It's not even quantum mechanics. Huh? It's something you see in electromagnetism, for instance. So this theta at in Cartesian coordinate, you can show that it's cos theta sine, no cos I. And we've got on J, we've got cos theta sine phi, that's a cos here, cos theta sine phi J, and then for the k coordinate, we've got minus actually, I was good, minus sine theta, I believe so. Yeah. Put parentheses here so that we don't get confused with where is the vector. That's for theta. Good. For phi, it's minus sine theta. No, that's minus sine phi I. So I can put this in front as well. and when we got the cosine of phi for j. Okay, so that's how to write these two vectors, this one and this one, in terms of this little vector I, j, k. Yeah, you can prove it again for yourself. Okay, so here now we can replace in this box here, we can replace this phi vector and theta vector by this expression. We collect the I and j and k, we collect the terms in this way, and if you do that, you should find, I leave it for you to check, that the z component, so the one that goes with k, is simply given by minus I h bar d d phi, I believe. Yeah, minus I h bar d phi. Yeah, there is the theta there. You see how the sine theta of the k would cancel with this one, which is there, and then you are left with this result. So that's the z component. Yeah, I don't tell you what are the x and the y, this is for the tutorial. Look it for yourself. But once you find them, the same way, you substitute this in this box and you collect the ij component. Once you do this, you can compute this. And you recognize this operator I, the L plus minus. And now we have the L plus minus expression in terms of the differential operators in the Cartesian basis. And I give you the result directly. Yeah, it's equal to this. So it's plus minus h bar exponential plus minus I phi d theta plus minus I cotangent, the cotangent of theta d phi. So you see that both in LZ, LX and LY as well, although you don't see it there because it's hidden in the tutorial, but also L plus minus, we don't have the R, the radial dependence. It's all in terms of the angle, theta phi. This one only phi actually. Which is very nice because angular momentum, we want it to be in terms of the angles of rotation, not of the distance, not of the radial part. Okay, so now you can solve this this eigen value equation, this one, because now we have the operator, so we can substitute this LZ, remove too much. We can substitute this LZ and L square for what we have computed and solve this differential equation. And you would find, we didn't compute L square, but we don't need L square actually. We can solve everything with LZ. Solving for LZ. So LZ psi LM, that's the two eigenvalues that are simultaneously eigenvalue for the eigenstate psi LM, which works for LZ and L square. So if we solve this first one, H bar M psi LM, if we substitute for this LZ that we have here, that should be equal to minus I h bar d phi psi LM. So psi LM is a function of theta and phi only, because as we said, there is no radial dependence anymore for this eigenstate. Yeah? It doesn't depend on R, it can be removed, the R relationship. So this we can solve very easily because this is, I can put this on, let me write again this equation by putting everything on the same size. We've got d phi of psi lm theta phi is equal to the h bar cancel. It's 1 divided by minus I, that's I m psi lm theta phi. And this we know how to solve, which function has the derivative equal to itself, bringing down a constant. This is clearly, so there is a dependence of theta. We don't know what it is. I mean, I can bury it in the function theta. Remember, this is my notation for capital theta. And then the phi dependence is I m phi, right? Doesn't matter the sign because m is, as we've seen before, is a sine integer from the minus bottom eigenvalue to the opposite. Yeah, so it has a sign anyway, so we don't care about the sign. Okay. And we can do the same, but we would need L square. We would need L square. L square, should I put this in your tutorial maybe? To find this theta, we need the other equation, which is L square of psi is h bar square L plus 1 psi. So L square, this L square, we can use again, we can use this expression that we used before and that comes from your previous tutorial, psi, yeah, because we've got LZ, we've got LZ square, that would be the second order derivative, yeah, second order derivative, and this L plus minus, where are they, the L plus minus, here they are. Okay, so L plus minus, if we copy this, we will copy it there. Again, we are not going to do it, it's just for you to see how to do it yourself. L plus L minus is h bar phi d theta plus I cotangent theta d phi, and then we apply this on the L minus. Let's change the color. Ooh, we need something fancy. Style, what color would befit this feast of algebra? Dark green. So L minus, I need to find my dark green here. L minus is the one that goes with the bottom sign. So we have to apply it there, so I copy, it's minus, so times minus, I put it in front, h bar square, the constant commute, this exponential I minus phi, this I have to keep there, but because you see that there is this operator which will apply on it, so it cannot be put at the beginning, and then I have to carry on in the space left, d theta minus I cotangent theta d phi. Okay, I'm closing the parenthesis. Very good. So again, as I said, we are not doing it because it's taking a bit of time. We only look at this term here. Yeah, that's these terms there. You have to add this one and you have to add this one. But if you do all this, you should arrive at the end of the day after the algebra. If you do it slowly, you should arrive at this equation that I write here: sine theta d theta. So now it's a straight derivative, it's total derivative, it's a normal derivative, because we are looking at this function of one variable. Yeah, because we can use this on the solution we already know, which is this part. So we can compute it and simplify. So we are left with the differential equation in one variable, which is sine theta d theta d theta plus L plus 1, this is the L from the eigen value, sine square theta minus m squared theta equals 0. That's our differential equation, which we need to solve. So we are not going to do it for two reasons. First, because it would be a bit tough. And second, because I think we are much over time. I'm not keeping track of the time, yeah? Which is a mistake, but I'm sure you can play this video with the 75% increase, speed increase, the voice is funnier. It might actually be closer to my normal voice if you speed it up, because this coronavirus is slowing down my normal frequency speech. And the second reason is that actually we already solved this equation. Believe it or not, we've seen it already. Yeah? I know it's unbelievable, but we've seen it already. Not today, not during this recording. Don't start again the recording to check. We've seen it when we were solving the Schrödinger equation for the hydrogen atom. Yeah, actually, these are the spherical harmonic. This is the same theta. Notation is taken the same for some good reason. Exponential I m phi. Yeah, theta phi. The solution of this equation is what contributes to the spherical harmonics. So this is very interesting result, provided, of course, I mean, these are solutions, and this is mathematical results. So we need to talk to some real mathematician or some mathematical books to find the solution to this differential equation. there exists provided that L is an integer. Yeah. Where did I find this color? This one. If L is an integer. But we've seen that L, it was our N over 2 initially. Yeah. This L is this guy here. That's the L. So it seems that some of the solutions, like this ones or this ones, are spurious. They don't exist. This one, fine. We can find the eigenstate in theta and phi space, in the real physical space, which work, which will provide the structure of the eigenvalue. We can find it for this. We can find it for this, but not there. This has no solution according to this equation. Yeah. So you might think that then it means that the procedure that we followed for the algebra of the angular momentum is just producing some unphysical result. This is not unexpected. I mean, it's not surprising. It happens all the time. It happened there, for instance. Yeah, this solution, for instance. You see, the one that was not good. Yeah, I mean, if you missed this joke before, I put it there again. Yeah? So the not good solution. So this is unphysical. Yeah. We don't use that, and the same would happen there. You would say, okay, so there is a lot of unphysical solution. We will see next lecture, and again, hopefully, I pray God that it will be like that. Speaking a lot of God, huh? It's because it's late in the night. It will be interactive, so it will not be me alone in my bed writing these notes. We'll be speaking together because I think it's not working very well to have me ranting like this, like a crazy old man. It's not good, but I don't want to start again, so I leave it at that. I will just conclude by saying that next time we'll see that these solutions, they do exist actually. Yeah, so they don't have solution, this one for instance, they don't have solution in the theta phi space, in the physical space. We cannot have angular momentum by changing theta and phi, but we can have some notion of rotation or angular momentum by looking at some intrinsic degree of freedom, which will give us access to this concept of spin, which is like intrinsic angular momentum, something that rotates or spins around itself, but not because it does so in space, like the electron, which is a cloud that moves around the nucleus, but also but because it intrinsically, naturally rotates as a fundamental nature of rotation. So these are actually good solutions. They exist, but they will require a different formalism, right? And we will turn to that next time. So actually, the most interesting angular momentum, I believe myself, is the scale of the spin. We'll pay special attention. Eventually, we'll first look at all the possible spin, but we'll pay special attention to this one, the spin, so-called spin 1/2, yeah, because that's very simple, that's very important, that's the spin of the electron, for instance. Okay, so as a summary of everything we did, today we looked at the problem of finding the eigenvalue and eigenfunctions of the angular momentum through its two compatible observables, which is the size, the magnitude, L square, and the Z component. And with a lot of efforts and sufferings, we finally succeeded in finding this relationship of the angular momentum. So the structure, you have it there. That's the structure of angular momentum. And the wave function in space, when n is the even integer, so when you go from minus h bar or minus integer multiple of h bar to plus the same multiple integer of h bar, the solution are the spherical harmonics. We skipped very little steps. We skipped the solution of this one, which we already did for the hydrogen atom. So the fault of this shortcoming can be sent back to this earlier lecture. Otherwise, we basically did either everything or everything is completed in the tutorial. Yeah. So please work out your tutorials. Stay safe. Keep being confined, especially Joel. And I see you next time, hopefully in person, as I said.